Great Lakes Now, Connect, is a co-production of Detroit Public Television and the Nature Conservancy.
Hi there, I'm Christy McDonald, and welcome to Great Lakes Now Connect, a program created by Detroit Public Television and the Nature Conservancy to focus on the biggest issues facing the Great Lakes and the impact they have on all of us living around the Great Lakes Basin in 8 states and 2 provinces of Canada. When you say Great Lakes to people, most identify with its beaches. Chances are you've spent time at a lakefront cottage, you've walked along the shoreline, watched a sunset, or waded into the waves. No two beaches are alike, whether it's a sandy shoreline or a cobblestone coastal area. And enjoying this magnificent natural resource is a tradition for millions who live along the water or visit every year.
Cleaning out the family home, getting it ready to sell, we were looking through boxes of pictures Mom had taken. I really like this one. I posted it on the Great Lakes Gazette. That's my blog about the people, places, things to do around Michigan. This is one Mom took on one of our annual trips to the Upper Peninsula. I shared it on the Great Lakes Gazette, and now people around the world have seen this little slice of the UP in the 1960s. Mom had a good eye for photography, even though she never had a fancy camera. Just an Instamatic with a flash cube on top. But I think she really captured something here. It's got a dreamy quality with the sky and the water meeting. A lot of people in Michigan piled in their cars and headed up north to the cottages, to the beaches. 5 kids in the car. We never had a station wagon. Once we crossed the Mackinac Bridge, it was time for lunch on the beach. This was 1961. I was 7. That's my brother and me in the water. Dad was taking a break from driving. The twins are looking for treasures in the sand. Dad, a Navy man, never was one to get in the water. I think I saw Mom in a bathing suit a couple of times. This is a rare photo of her. We've got 3,200 miles of coastline along the Great Lakes. Maybe we who live here tend to take them for granted. Now vacations can be much more exotic. People go to the other end of the continent or the other side of the world. After the Navy, my dad worked on the Great Lakes freighters for a short time. My brother did too. You can actually spend time on a lake boat. That's what they call them. You could win a trip in a raffle. I'd like to experience that. I guess it's the romance of the seas, that connection to water. It's timeless. It's something to treasure.
It is something to treasure, and this intersection of land and water is also the most expensive to protect. Green-colored water tinged from algal blooms and shoreline covered with sharp zebra mussel shells can keep tourists away. So is it safe to go to the beach this summer? This starts our conversation on beaches and water quality in the Great Lakes. Today we've gathered experts from around the basin to take an in-depth look at what is happening and what is being done to restore these areas. We want to hear what you have to say, plus answer any questions you may have. So follow us on Twitter at Great Lakes Now. You can use the hashtag Great Lakes for our conversation today. We also invite you to head to greatlakesnow.org for more information. So let's start now with panel number one. It's moderated by Dr. Catherine Call, Conservation Policy and Practices Specialist at the Nature Conservancy.
Well, they wanted to roll back that stormwater.
Thank you, Christy. My name's Katie Call. I'm the Conservation Policy and Practices Specialist for the Nature Conservancy in Michigan and the Great Lakes region. And we're pleased to have with us today Joan Rose, Dr. Joan Rose, the Homer Nolan Chair in Water Research and Co-Director of the Center for Water Sciences and Center for Advancing Microbial Risk Assessment at Michigan State University Department of Fisheries and Wildlife, based in East Lansing, Michigan. We have Steve Madewell. He's Director of Toledo Metro Parks in Ohio. And we have Joe Nestor. He's the owner and a consultant at Nestor Ag, and his firm provides agricultural consulting in Northwest Ohio, Southern Michigan, and Northeastern Indiana. So thanks so much to you all for being here to talk about an important issue today. We just saw a video on what the Great Lakes mean to one writer and her family. And certainly you all come here with different perspectives, different experiences in the Great Lakes and in your professional world. Tell us a little bit, each of you, about what the Great Lakes mean to you or what they mean to the people who you work with. Joan?
Yeah, so, well, I'm a public health water microbiologist, and my first visit to the Great Lakes was during the Milwaukee outbreak, caused by Cryptosporidium, a parasite. So I really focus on water quality, and working up here now the past 10 years at Michigan State University in the Great Lakes region, there's a historical legacy around water quality in this region. And water quality means health, and it means health to people, it means health to the wildlife, it means health to our ecosystem, and it means health to our economy. And the beaches are where the people meet the shoreline. And so they're really sort of an indicator to me of how much we care about the Great Lakes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I recall the very first time that I saw Lake Erie. I was, 10 to 12 years old, somewhere in that period, and the water was pea green soup color, the color of pea soup. And since that time, having the opportunity to work with several park districts in Ohio and work with managing properties that feed into the Lake Erie watershed, to see the effects of the Clean Water Act and see how that water has recovered on so many levels has been, really an incredibly motivational experience. But at the same time, to see us at a brink of letting that slip away again is just very, very disturbing. And I think that we just have to be committed to not only managing the water quality directly, but the watersheds that feed into the Great Lakes. And for the 30 plus million people that live in the Great Lakes region, we really have to have an ownership and a commitment to seeing it taken care of properly.
Mm-hmm. What about you, Joe?
Well, in agriculture, the number one thing that controls the yield of the plants is water. So everybody in ag is familiar with water and its importance. But at the beaches, I think, you want clean, clear, safe water. A lot of people, that's their vacation time and their chance to get away and get that hands-on on the water. So we want to make sure that the water is very clean and agriculture is doing their part to keep it that way.
That's right. So summer's coming. Are any of you, do you have big concerns about going to the beach this summer? How are you feeling?
Well, I know when I was the director at Lake Metro Parks, we had a half a dozen natural area beaches and one very active, guarded beach and whatnot. And one of the concerns that we always had, of course, was just general safety, for people coming out and being exposed to the water, especially early in the spring or early in the summer when the water temperatures are cool and they can, have some issues that way. And the small personal crafts and not being properly acclimated to what they're doing. But really, one of the things we were always concerned about, and one of the big unknowns, was water quality and the human health contact factor. And that's a big issue.
Mm-hmm. The studies they've done in the Great Lakes region, starting even 50 years ago and more recently in the last few years, the Centers for Disease Control and EPA, they have found that at some beaches where there are pollution sources that there's a chance, 1 in 10 chance of somebody getting sick because of water quality degradation. And so I think that you do have to be aware of the broader impacts of what we do on the land, how that's impacting the beaches, and that can, translate into actual illnesses.
The thing that concerns me would be an algal bloom outbreak. We've had some of those recent years. Last year was pretty minimal, but we're still learning about those, the exact causes, but that would be the thing. It's unsightly. It can ruin a day at the beach or on the lake, and it affects so many different things.
Mm-hmm. So we're getting at, we understand why we all value the Great Lakes, but we're getting at some of these ways in which the lakes and the beaches that we enjoy in the summertime are threatened right now. So talk to me a little bit about the human health threats exactly that we are experiencing, maybe some of the economic threats that are tied to beach contamination or water contamination, and then the effects on those coastal systems, those coastal wetlands that we care about. What are some of the threats, or the sources of those threats that we're experiencing?
Well, you know, when you can get ill from a number of microorganisms, and they mostly come from waste, that either human waste or animal waste. So the sources can be wastewater treatment plants that aren't being treated very well. They can come from CSOs, septic tanks, leaky sewer lines. Stormwater is a big driver, of non-point pollution coming from animal waste. And this is a whole group of microbes, bacteria, viruses, parasites. They're causing, stomach problems, skin problems, eye infections, ear infections, respiratory infections. And so, the goal is to really monitor water quality and be assured that there's good public health advisories going on. And in the long term, really looking at where are these contaminants coming from? That is a big issue.
So how big of a problem is it? Are people really getting sick often? I mean, if I'm somebody who lives in the middle of a Great Lakes state and I go to the beach just two or three times a year, why should I be concerned? Am I as concerned as somebody who lives in a house near the shoreline?
We do know that there's varying levels of exposure, but there's certain beaches. We have some good historical data now, and the Great Lakes does an excellent job keeping a record. And we are seeing that we have advisories and closures up to about 15% of the beaches. And some beaches are chronically a problem. And so they are polluted more often than not. I think if you're a consumer, you can look up these websites, you can look up these data sets now, which is just great, because say you're a mom, you're going to go there the whole day, you're going to have a picnic with kids and a birthday. You know that kids are going to be playing in the water. They're going to have greater exposure. We already know that. And you want to go someplace where you believe that they're going to be safe.
Mm-hmm. What are some indicators of a healthy beach or a sick beach? Can you tell? Are there any factors that people should be made aware of?
So the monitoring, of course, is for a bacteria called E. coli. Mm-hmm. And so we've got good monitoring data. You can go on websites and look at what the historical water quality is at that beach. And now they're starting to look at whether you can get real-time information, sort of like a weather forecast. Mm-hmm. So the bacterial water quality, and sometimes it's visible, sometimes it's these algal blooms. Mm-hmm. And the algal blooms also exacerbate not just the toxins, but the other bacteria as well in the water. So sometimes there's some visible, algal mats and things like that could key you in. Mm-hmm. And good beaches are groomed, and so there is some visible, signs there when there's a nice groomed beach.
Mm-hmm. Steve, in your experience with the metro parks, from a recreational standpoint, do you see people reacting to beach closures in a certain way? Do they remember from week to week or year to year? What does it cost a community if a beach gets closed?
It's a huge factor from the recreational travel and tourism dollars. I mean, there's in Ohio, about 19% of Lake Erie's shoreline is public access. Okay, so of that 19%, a very small percentage of that is developed as public beaches. Okay, so we're going to take Joan's situation and, we're going to take a picnic or an outing to the beach. We don't think in terms of going to the beach and having Lake Erie water be contaminated or Great Lakes water be contaminated to the point that we can't go there. We have a fairly limited number of groomed beaches to go to. And when we get there, if it's closed, the whole day is just, trash or goes down the tubes. When you start looking at across the Great Lakes, there were 62 beaches sampled last year, and 22 of those had an excess of public health standards that were the ones that were researched. And you know, when you start looking at the total impact across the Great Lakes region, at least from the research that I had, it's about 3,400 days worth of beach closures there. And I haven't been able to find what that represents as far as dollars, but it's a very significant amount of money.
Sure, the tourism that comes into
Absolutely.
That town, the place they buy their gas, the hotel they might stay in, the restaurants they might go to, any other activities they might take part in there.
Yes, certainly.
Sure. So we've heard about the microbial contamination part. Certainly there's runoff from urban areas and agricultural areas. Could you speak to that a little bit, Joe?
Well, one of the things that the nutrient that's required for crop production, phosphorus.
Right, and also, by nutrients we mean fertilizers.
Right, also drives the blue-green algal blooms. And so we need to do a better job of keeping those nutrients in the field. And so there's a lot of research going on out there, a lot of reevaluating of the way practices that we've used to incorporate and changing some practices, incorporating a lot of technology, mm-hmm. and making sure that those nutrients stay in there. But that would be the primary thing from agriculture is phosphorus driving
okay.
that agriculture algal bloom.
Okay. Can you help me understand the link between the phosphorus and the algal bloom? What happens?
Well, as far as I know, the algae thrives on that phosphorus. It's dissolved reactive phosphorus.
It's different than other.
So it's not exactly the phosphorus that's applied to the fields, but it is another form that has the ability to wash off from the field in surface waters.
Okay. And you mentioned that farmers have an economic interest in keeping those fertilizers, those nutrients on their field for higher crop yields. Can you give me a comparison of what it costs them to?
Well, the nutrients are very costly in the farming budget. It costs about $600 an acre to put out an acre of corn. And those nutrients, when I test soils and advise farmers on what to apply to raise their projected crop, it's all accounted for in the crop production. Nothing is accounted for in leaving the field. So anything that leaves is costly. So fortunately, economics are on the side of doing the right thing here. So a farmer could, by applying at the wrong time, could possibly lose $40 to $50 an acre in nutrients.
Okay, and as I've understood it, there's really a window of time in the spring that a farmer can maximize getting the crop in the field, getting the nutrients on the crop before. There's just a small window of time, and I also saw a recommendation through a report that just came out that said to avoid nutrient application if the chance of rain is greater than 50%. Is that a realistic expectation, or?
Well, I think it is. The impression might be that farmers have the entire year to apply those nutrients, and due to growing crops and wet field conditions and various other things, snow cover, you eliminate most of the year. Actually, you get down to about a 2 to 3 week window
okay.
when all this work has to be done.
Okay.
And then you throw in weather and the chance of heavy rains, now you really get pinned into narrow windows. But farmers do need to watch that and try to pick a time that suits safety and less risk. And if they don't get that window, then I'm fine knowing the inventories of nutrients in the soil, and we'll apply it next fall
okay.
when that window is open.
And so speaking of variable weather, I know that climate change is an exacerbating factor. We're seeing higher temperatures overall. We're seeing warmer surface water temperatures on the Great Lakes, and we're seeing more variable rainfall, more intense storm events. Joan, can you help us tie together what climate change might mean for some of this?
Yeah, right now we do know that high precipitation events is actually tied to outbreaks where a whole community could experience a contamination event and a high percentage of the population could actually get sick. At the beach site, we know that about 8% of the beach closures are tied to these rain events. But there's a large percentage where we don't know. And we're finding out more and more about what we do on the land and how the precipitation in particular drives the pollution. And you can kind of you know, understand that, just drives it from the source to the beach. Mm-hmm. And it's not these soft rain events, it's some of these high intense rain events that are really bringing the contamination from the land to the beach very, very quickly.
Mm-hmm. I think I've seen a statistic that from 1958 to 2007, on the Upper Great Lakes, we've seen, or maybe it's the Upper Northeast, we've seen a 31% increase in the top highest 1% of heavy rain events. So that's, to your point, we're seeing these intense storm events, which is challenging these farmers who are trying to get nutrients on the field at a certain time to avoid losing them, going right into the water, increasing the potential for algal blooms.
It's not just the farmer is not the only the issue or problem here or challenge. That's the combined sewer overflow system.
The urban issues too.
And that is really a tremendous driver in the beach closures because a lot of the beaches are near urban areas. And so when we get these high intensity storm events, what happens is we get the combined sewer, we get billions of gallons
combined
every
sewer
year.
Meaning stormwater and sewer.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Billions of gallons of untreated sewage going into the Great Lakes every year. And it's my understanding that the highest percentage of combined sewer systems in the country are in the Great Lakes Basin.
Yep. And we have to spend quite a bit of money to fix that, but when you think, and I think the estimates that I've seen is that it's going to cost a community anywhere from $37,000, I've seen as high as $200,000 a day if there's a beach closure. So these long-term fixes of infrastructure, and it's fixing the CSOs, fixing, you know, our stormwater systems, fixing our sewer system and upgrading our wastewater facilities, all of that is going to make a difference in the long run, especially under climate, what is predicted to happen under these climate change mm-hmm. scenarios.
Okay, let's switch gears just a little bit. I think we have a video that was produced before this segment looking at the intersection between water quality and fish consumption.
The Great Lakes region is an angler's dream. Thousands of lakes, rivers, and streams teeming with freshwater fish. The water is sparkling, the fish are biting, and the sun is finally shining. After a long, hard winter, these anglers are ready to cast their lines. And for many in the Metro Detroit area, that means fishing the Detroit River.
It's the Detroit River. I love my city. I live 2 or 3 miles away. I can come almost every day.
Usually a big perch right here. That's what, you know, perch and then the walleye.
It ain't nothing like fresh right out the river.
But with power plants and steel factories hugging its shoreline, many people question just how safe consuming fish from the Detroit River can be.
There's all the power plants around. I mean, I've been seeing a lot of stuff float up and down this river and, you know, it's in the water. I mean, it looks beautiful, but I mean, I can't really trust it. It might be dirty.
The environmental hazards of the Detroit River may be egregious, but they are in no way unique. Many of the contaminants found in the Detroit River can be found throughout the Great Lakes region.
PCBs is one of the contaminants. They've been banned, but they're still in use and they're still deposited. Another contaminant is mercury. Mercury is still in use. It comes from coal incineration and things like that, so we have deposition into our waters, and that results in them getting into the fish.
Each year, the Michigan Department of Community Health collects data on water bodies throughout the state.
It's our job to provide information to people about fish from our water bodies and the chemicals that may or may not be in them.
The findings are published in the Michigan Fish Advisory, helping the public discern which fish are safe to eat.
We try to dispel the myth that you can't eat anything from the Detroit River, because that's not true. There are good fish to eat from the river, but there are some that are pretty highly contaminated. So we try to help people make choices about which fish are better to eat.
Many anglers on the Detroit River need to fish to feed their families and their neighbors. Informing these anglers of the fish advisories can have a deep impact on community health.
Next week, this park is going to be inundated with people.
To make sure this information gets to the people who need it most, the Michigan Department of Community Health hired river walkers, locals like Robert and Jim, whose sole job is to explain the fish advisories directly to anglers on the Detroit River.
Good morning. How's everyone this morning? You guys catching any fish?
Not yet.
Not yet? We're from Wayne State University and Department of Community Health, and we're here to provide information to the fishermen about the fish in the river. This brochure tells you which fish, going from top to bottom, are the cleanest to catch, eat.
The importance of having Jim and Robert out here is to get those printed materials into the hands of people who can actually use them.
This tells you how to cook the fish so that the grease falls away from the fish.
And I got one in here?
You got, have one of those in your hand. I try not to load you down, I just go over it.
You can practice safe fishing by choosing the right fish. Knowing how to process your fish, you can remove a huge amount of your PCBs in fish by removing the skin and removing the fatty part of the fish. And if you process your fish, grilling it, letting the fat drip away from the fish and not re-frying your fish in the fish oils over and over again, you can make fishing in the Detroit River very healthy.
The Detroit River is a wonderful asset to the city and community to be enjoyed by all. Environmental factors change continually, but with the proper knowledge, we can continue to enjoy this wonderful asset for sport and for a healthy local food source.
Thank you. We just heard or saw a video about how water quality issues can affect people through the fish that they're eating out of these rivers. So maybe we could talk a little bit about how different aquatic and terrestrial, so animals that live in the water, animals that live on the land, how different wildlife populations are affected by water quality. Where exactly, how are these animals coming into contact if they aren't water animals with contamination? And then how are they getting sick, and how does this affect people?
Well, I think you have to recognize, or we have to recognize, that the contaminations are not necessarily coming out of a pipe in the field. You know, they're not coming out of a sewer pipe, from a municipal treatment plant, that they may be atmospheric in origin as far as rainwater and what have you. And so the source of contamination is very broad spread, and consequently that introduces a whole system of variables that's hard for most folks to get their head around. But you know what we start seeing is manifestation of mercury in fish, like the video was referring to. And most health departments, state health departments and Michigan DNR, Ohio DNR, most of the DNRs associated with wildlife management, try to do a really good job of educating their clientele on how to prepare the fish and do that whole sort of thing. But it's a very complex system, and there's a lot of variables there.
Okay. There's been some discussion about connection with large colonies of birds and contamination on beaches. Is that which birds, which beaches? What do we need to think about?
Yeah, you know, I mean, we share our shoreline, with the wildlife. And that those ecosystem services are really important. If we have a healthy, wildlife system, we have good bird habitat, we have a good relationship between birds and fish and humans and beaches and that type of thing. We do know that there's different types of microbes that can affect birds that can also affect humans. These are called zoonotic pathogens. And we don't know very much about these types of pathogens. We do see that Clostridium botulinum shows up every once in a while in birds and has a bird kill, and that's been somewhat tied to algal blooms and that type of thing. So it's then you see that it's quite obvious that you're having a wildlife problem. You might have a fish kill because of low DO. But often it's not very obvious that these things are going on. And we don't know very much about the bird population and how many of them are infected with these different types of bacteria. And it's very difficult to, I think, monitor wildlife and then see how it's connected to humans. I mean, some of these things are obvious if you talk about the chemicals and their accumulation. And we have good monitoring data on that in the sediments and in the fish and in the birds. But for many of these things, we just don't have the data yet.
Okay.
Yeah, we've seen a really an explosion of the greater Canadian goose, for example, in the past 25 years. And that's a wonderful thing. You know, if you start having hundreds of birds coming in and basically day roosting at your beach site, you know, just the manure production becomes a problem.
So a good reason not to feed the gulls, is that what you're telling us?
You know, and we've seen various populations of animals increase. And of course, you know, being a wildlife enthusiast, that's a wonderful thing. But, you know, being a resource manager, there's the other side of that equation too, right?
Mm-hmm. Managing their habitat and that type of thing, you know, I think is important.
Absolutely. So we have regulations in place. We have water treatment facilities and industries and farms being tested and meeting these standards and passing, in many cases, the tests. Why are we still having beach closures, and why are people still getting sick? Yeah. That's a big question.
Oh, yeah. Well, we made such great progress since the Clean Water Act.
Absolutely.
And in fact, in the Great Lakes region, even before the Clean Water Act was initiated, infrastructure was being put in place. Well, we're talking about aging infrastructure now and really having to think, what do we want for the future? What do we want for the 21st century? And we have these new tools. It's great being in water microbiology. The group of us that do this, I think the Wisconsin Health Department coined it, but they're the CSI of water. You know, they go in and they can take water samples. We can take these water samples now, and we can look at the DNA of the bacteria. And we can start to identify the sources of the pollution. And the non-point sources, the point sources, how much they're related to rainfall, wind, and other storm events. This means with this knowledge, we're going to have a much better way to, one, communicate the public health risk in real time, and secondly, for the long term, find the problem sites, find the, what's causing the problem and fix it. And it's a collective issue. It's not going to just be that city's problem, that city's problem upstream. It's got to be a watershed, solution. And I think we're developing the tools so that we can answer those questions of how bad is the pollution, how significant is the public health risk, and what can we do about it.
Mm-hmm. So, speaking of solutions, let's talk a little bit more about what different researchers, different industries, municipalities, or agencies are putting into place as they are coming to realize, Joan gave a really nice summary, coming to realize a lot of these threats. Through the ag sector, what are folks thinking about?
Well, it is recognized that ag has a role in this, and we've been working on it. This problem didn't happen overnight, and it won't be solved overnight. Mm-hmm. But there's been a lot of changes in agriculture, exciting changes, in the last 10 years. We have plants with stronger roots and better nutrient recovery systems. So we're looking at research that maybe we don't need the amount of nutrients that we needed 20 years ago to raise a bushel of corn. There's a lot of talk on soil health and soil structure as opposed to just looking at nutrients. Technology in agriculture is on a steep climb upward. We're applying fertilizer now by georeference zones within fields that we individually sample and then vary the rate of the fertilizer through computerized controllers within the fertilizer application machines.
So just enough in the places that need it.
Exactly. They call it precision ag, site-specific, and so we're spoon-feeding areas of the field instead of blanket approaches that could tend to over-fertilize.
So then how do good actors trying to do the right thing benefit versus bad actors? How will this play out?
As I said before, there's economics here. And the one that can keep the nutrients at home in the crop production factory is going to win. There's a process out there now that agriculture is employing called the 4 R's. And what that means is the right source of nutrient, the right rate, the right time, and the right place. And the right rate, we can do that with adequate soil testing and representing what nutrients are there. That's a pretty simple one to do. Timing, the right time, is being recognized as probably more valuable than anything by looking at the weather, the pending weather, what your soil conditions are. When we get rains, we want it to run in the soil and not off. So farmers are using conservation tillage practices that create more of a sponge effect on the soil so we can hold that water. They don't want it to run off. They're going to need it for crop production.
Mm-hmm. One of the things that's great about agriculture is there's individual practitioners. You know, the issue that Joan was alluding to with sanitary systems in urban areas or in urban regions, it's much more difficult to address those things because you're talking about big infrastructure changes, and a lot of communities are dealing with that. But since 1972, the amount of untreated pollution or sewage that's going into the Great Lakes has been reduced by half, so we've made great strides. The unknown variable, though, is the intensity of storm events. Okay, so as these systems are being engineered to meet current standards, our weather patterns or our incidents of heavy rains are also shifting too. So that may pose a partial answer, at least, to your question. Why are we still having beach closures? Mm-hmm. You know, we're still defining what the new normal is.
Okay, so how are we testing? You know, talk about some of the solutions for different ways that we're testing. You mentioned that technology is advancing in the ag sector. What about in the human health sector?
Yeah, so our traditional way of testing is taking a water sample, getting it back to the lab, growing up the bacteria, and the next day you have the results. But it's 24 hours too late to tell people.
So if you went to the beach yesterday.
Yes. So that's been recognized for quite a long time. And so there's two approaches that now that are being used. One is the DNA techniques are very rapid. And so California is testing a whole system, and I know it's being tested by some public health entities in the Great Lakes. You can get the sample in the morning by 11 o'clock before people are getting out to the beach. You can have the result posted. So it's very rapid. It's for bacteria that have a strong relationship to water quality and health. But the second approach is actually like the weathermen. You know, they've actually built good forecasts where they know, based on their beach, when the wind is right, the sunlight is right, the direction, the rain, all of these things moving the contamination onto the beach. So these forecasting systems, and I think Ohio has a very good system that they've been evaluating over 5 years, they're sort of like the weather report. They can actually get very close 95% of the time and post the likelihood that the beach would be impacted real time on that day. And so it's all moving to a direction where there's going to be better public health messaging and a better assessment of water quality. And that's going to move upstream to what we need to do to fix our infrastructure.
You find that people are responding to this predictive forecasting?
Yeah, but it is still, it's a confusing thing for most folks to get their head around. I mean, for example, if you have a beach on the east side of a river and on the west side of the river, and you have a big storm event, literally the way the wind is blowing can have an effect on which beach is closed and which beach is acceptable. And so Joan, when she was talking about the predictor model or the predictive model, it is looking at all of those variables and giving you like 80% chance that this is going to be bad today. And folks may come to one beach and say, well, wait a second. Why are those people over there swimming? It literally can be that site specific. And so trying to get folks to dial in and to recognize that this is an issue and it's something that they can seek out the information on. Oh, that's all right. I was going to say, you know, there's been discussion about creating phone apps. There are internet sites, at least in Ohio, mm-hmm. where you can log on and you can get the handful of beaches or so that they're currently testing like that right now. You can get that information in a short, virtually real time. It's not quite real time, but it's close. And that's posted up. But it's just a question of getting, you know, the public to think that way. And I really believe that if we could make greater headway and public awareness, we would make greater strides towards looking at these infrastructure improvements as investments and not cost burdens.
Right, it's not something that you can always directly see. And mm-hmm. so it's hard to make the case if you're not being connected with the information.
Right.
That's right.
That type of information could be very valuable to agriculture too. We've got a lot of farmers that are installing water control devices on their tile systems, and if they could predict the weather out far enough, they can know whether they can hold that water back and maybe eliminate some of the flashiness of some of these rain events in the stream, hold it within the tile system and keep it for crop use or let it out at a later time.
That's amazing. I read about a study yesterday that the National Science Foundation is funding where they have a new thunderstorm detection project going on where they're able to, they're funding a project so that they can predict these massive thunderstorms, these big flashy rain events that we're talking about, not just a couple hours in advance when 50-50 chance, but up to a day in advance, 100%, you are going to get this. Be prepared. So not only would it be good if you're planning to go to the beach for a picnic, but certainly it's going to be good if you're thinking about when to apply nutrients on a field and these water release devices that you just talked about. What other kind of research do you feel like, you know, we've talked about some of the solutions that are taking place, but what do we need to be asking for as research entities are out there? How do we help direct what's taking place next and or suggest what's needed in each of your sectors to help move the ball forward with water quality and beach health?
Water management, I mean, volume management is huge. And that's what Joe's talking about with the agricultural side of things, and they're trying to develop or they're working to develop very, very specific things, just like the precision ag applications of fertilizers. Some of the techniques that we were talking about before the show, having individual, you know, backflow preventers and small gates on the tile, the miles and miles of tile that's underground in all these ag fields, and being able to control the release and keeping it slow. In urban settings, the notion of detention basins and retention ponds being built into the infrastructure is a huge component. And some of the opportunities I think that we have, especially with some of the urban areas where we have vacant landscapes, we may be able to take and put water quality handling structures in those vacant landscapes.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that, you know, in the environmental science world, people are starting to talk about this idea of big data and what's bigger than the Great Lakes. And it's all about space and time. Can we get a handle on what, you know, on assessment and then moving forward? With all the new tools we have the tools. And I think now it's, and we actually gathered a huge amount of data. In fact, there was a 100-year study done in 1912 where it's the largest bacteriological study I could ever find right here in the Great Lakes. So we have the data. We need to move into the sort of the information, that environmental science bioinformation, where we analyze the data to make sense of it, make decisions. So I think that the research in this area really needs to support the new tools and techniques, gather the big data, but go the next step, the analysis of the data and the decision science part of it, because I think we're going to see the potential for great things to happen, you know, in the next decade.
Okay. NRCS has a tool available to farmers today called adaptive management, and it's where farmers can be supported to put out field demonstration and research plots to evaluate the best management practices for nutrients under their management styles. And every farmer's got a little bit different style. It's not a one-size-fits-all, but that's an item that I think there'll be some real good information come out of, good data that a lot of people with like systems can implement in their operations. Mm-hmm.
We just have a few more seconds, but quickly, what can folks who are watching this right now at home, what are things they can do in their daily lives to help with water quality and safer beaches? Any ideas?
Well, I think being mindful of the fact that storm sewers go to the rivers or go to the lake.
It's connected.
And, you know, when you read about somebody dumping, you know, antifreeze or something in a storm sewer and having fish kills down the river, that should be like a beacon for everybody. Be mindful of what you dispose of.
I think people should know and learn about their beach, what I call the beach shed. So they've got their local beach, their river they love to fish at. Learn about that watershed. Learn about what's going on, because you ultimately will be making decisions about how to protect that water for the future.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I think we have one question from the public that we're going to see on video in a moment here.
How you doing? This is Aaron, and I want to know, is it safe to eat the fish out the water by these power plants?
All right. Is it safe to eat fish out of water by power plants?
Well, there's a tremendous amount of research that's been done about eating fish out of the Great Lakes. And all of the individual states, all the individual health departments have very extensive research on how to prepare the fish, what kind of fish, the frequency of consumption, you know, whether you should eat fish if you're planning on having a child, if you're a woman. And so there's a lot of information out there. Unfortunately, it's not a one-size-fits-all response. And so it's incumbent on the angler, okay, to know where the fish is coming from and what the local best information is.
We just talked about there are different websites and app and smartphone apps out there that you can check to look at water quality at different places around the Great Lakes, right?
Yeah.
And, so certainly and that would be advisable.
DNRs, almost all of the DNRs have advisory pages where they tell you how to prepare the fish, and what fish you can eat, the frequency of consumption.
Yeah, and it might not be that it's just because it's located near a, you know, near the power plant discharge. You know, you may need to be aware of that because of the mercury, as the videos, demonstrated. That's coming from atmospheric deposition. Mm-hmm. So PCBs and mercury and other things that could accumulate in the fish could be, a risk anywhere. So certainly go to the state's websites and again, know your water system.
That's right. Not just the threats right at that power plant for whatever might be flowing out or atmospheric deposition, but whatever's upriver from that coming down,
right.
The whole context.
Fish like the warm water, and they like wastewater effluent discharges too.
Lovely. I think we have a question from our audience.
My name is Joe St. John. I'm from St. Clair Shores. My question is, what are we doing to solve the near shore pollution problem of Lake St. Clair?
Well,
I'll just say that I know there's a lot of activity right now via scientists in NOAA, and Michigan State University has been working with the health department in Lake St. Clair, and they're going upstream to understand what's coming in to Lake St. Clair through the river. Just recently, some cores were taken. These go back 60 years, and the layers tell the history of the ebb and flow of some of the pollution, both the nutrients and the bacteria. And so I think this is going to give us, you know your past, maybe you can know your future. And I also think the health department's doing a really good job of trying to find licit sewage and septic tank impacts into the system. So it's a long-term solution, a long-term commitment, I think, to improving the blue economy, I think, in Lake St. Clair.
And back to the what can the average person do, maintaining your septic systems, having them serviced regularly, being aware of what you can do within your own household. We have another question.
I'm Jim Newman with the Detroit Yacht Club, and actually, you kind of touched on what we can all do individually. I mean, industry is doing everything they can to figure out and solve their problems. Agriculture is doing the same thing. But if there was one magic button that every resident could do right now, today, that's not a big deal, but one little thing that would make a dramatic difference in water quality, what would that one thing be?
I guess my suggestion would be realize that it's everybody's water.
Right.
And we're all in this together.
Yeah, I think that's really what it boils down to. I mean, it would be great if we could find, just like the gentleman's question about the, Lake St. Clair, that if we could find one pipe to turn it off, if we could find one smokestack to shut it down, but it isn't that way. We all are driving cars, we all are taking showers, we're all running dishwashers, we're all doing all of these things and trying to minimize our water consumption, and the amount of waste that we produce is a huge huge contribution.
All right. Panelists, thank you so much. If you have any final thoughts, we can certainly share them now, but really appreciate your time and all of the experience and perspective that you've provided today. So thanks very much. And I think we're going to hear from Christy now.
Thanks so much, Catherine. And you are watching Great Lakes Now Connect and our conversation about clean beaches, water quality, and the shoreline of the Great Lakes. We just wrapped up our first panel. There are a lot of great points, a lot of good questions there. So if you'd like to get in on the conversation, make sure you reach out through Twitter and through Facebook. You will find us at Great Lakes Now. And joining me right now to talk about how we can keep track of how clean our local beaches are is Christine Mannanen. She's the Communications and Great Lakes Information Network Director for the Great Lakes Commission. Christine, thanks so much for joining me. I appreciate it.
It's nice to be here.
When we talk about apps, there's always an app for that. And so you have something called the My Beachcast app. Tell us about that.
We do. The Great Lakes Commission and the Great Lakes States created the My Beachcast app to serve data about beaches in our Great Lakes region. So we focus on more than 1,800 beaches. And in Michigan, that includes Great Lakes beaches as well as inland beaches. So people can go on the app and find out where beaches are. So whether they're a resident that frequents our beaches or a tourist visiting the area. We also offer advisory information. So if there's a water quality warning or advisory, people will find it there. And we add weather forecasts and weather information. So really useful information for people to find.
It absolutely is. So what was the thought that came up? What was the meeting that the Great Lakes Commission said, you know, we've got to have something where people can actually see where they're going to go and how clean the area is?
Well, we felt that this information was very important to public health, but yet people weren't able to find it easily. And the idea for an app came up because we wanted people to be able to find the information on the fly. You know, if they're looking, traveling in a car on the way to a beach, or their child wants to go to a beach and they can find out the beaches in their area. We've also, we're very proud that this year we're adding beach hazard alerts to the app. So information on rip currents, for instance, which is a very common threat to swimmers in the Great Lakes. And we've experienced quite a few drownings in recent years where people get caught in currents offshore and they can't get out of them. So this is additional information that we're adding as public health and safety information that we really want people to use and find.
You know, and a lot of these things take funding and take money. And so was this was funded by the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative?
It was. It was a two-year project funded by EPA, GLRI. We've had several partners work with us. I mentioned all the Great Lakes states are offering their data that's being retrieved on the fly for the app. And we also worked with a firm in Ann Arbor, Limnotech, who helped us put together the front-end interface for the app. So it's been a great partnership.
You know, tourism is, of course, a huge part of the Great Lakes region and here in Michigan, and the Pure Michigan campaign, and trying to get people to come and enjoy the beaches and enjoy the waters. How important is it to make sure that people have that proper information that when they come here, and to keep those tourism numbers growing so they know that they come and can enjoy a clean beach?
Absolutely. We actually have a new publication that we just released that's going to be in all the Michigan Welcome Centers and at all of our beaches in the region. And you can find out all the information on the app and other online products in this little pub. So we encourage people to pick this up and share it with their friends and family.
When you have a beach or a recreation area that is closed down because of E. coli issues or any number of problems, how does that impact a region and their tourism?
Greatly. There's great economic impacts when there's a beach closure. Again, it's kind of a two-way street. We want to inform people to protect public health, but we don't want to inflict undue, you know, harm to our people visiting beaches. You know, we want to keep the beach numbers up because the region has beautiful beaches and, you know, we want people to enjoy them, but enjoy them safely.
As a communications director and trying to get the message out there about the magnificent resource that is the Great Lakes, do you find that people are starting to make more of a connection between what they do in everyday life, how it affects the lakes, and treasuring more the resource that we do have?
Absolutely. Yeah, I think especially residents in this region, I think sometimes underappreciate where they live and you know, there's just these beautiful resources around us, and I think oftentimes you take for granted what's in your backyard. So we want to really increase even residents' use of this app and finding out about the beautiful places that they can visit and, you know, protecting their family's health as well.
Absolutely, and it definitely is an easy way that people can see where they're going to go and the health of the beach. So tell us again what we need to look for when we get online.
To find the app, you go to beachcast.glen.net. Mm-hmm. It's part of the Great Lakes Information Network. And you can download, if you have an Android phone, you can download the app itself. We are developing an iPhone app as well.
Okay.
And there's also a mobile-friendly website where people on other devices can access the information as well.
And this is great information people have as we start to round towards Memorial Day weekend and the start of the summer season, and the flip-flops on the beach app look very inviting, I have to say.
Thank you.
All right, Christine Mannanen, thank you so much for joining us. We appreciate it.
Thank you. It was a pleasure.
And if you want to learn more information about that BeachCast app, you can go to our website at greatlakesnow.org for all things Great Lakes. And you are watching Great Lakes Now Connect, a joint production between Detroit Public Television and the Nature Conservancy to focus on some of the biggest issues that are facing the Great Lakes. And again, if you'd like to join the conversation, you can use the hashtag Great Lakes if you are on Twitter, and you can also find us on Facebook. Now, if you have enjoyed the Great Lakes, if you have gone fishing, or if you have gone boating at all, and you've watched the news reports over the last year, you know that there is concern about the lake levels right now. The levels are near historic lows, and that has a major impact. Joining me now is Keith Kompaltowicz. He is the Chief of Watershed Hydrology for the Army Corps of Engineers in Detroit. Keith, thanks so much for joining
me.
I appreciate
it.
So why don't you go ahead and give us an idea of what you do with the Army Corps of Engineers.
Well, my office releases the official forecasts for the Great Lakes. We do that on a monthly basis. It's a six-month forecast, and we do that in collaboration with plenty of other federal agencies, and as well as counterparts in the Canadian agencies.
So this is really an international.
It really is. And the mm-hmm. collaboration that is ongoing in the Great Lakes with respect to what causes water levels to rise and fall is really grown, especially in the recent years.
So tell us, what do you do on a day-to-day basis in terms of monitoring? How does it all work?
Well, again, we use different data sets from different sources. The National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration in the U.S. and the Canadian Hydrographic Service in Canada operates the water level gauges that measure the rises and falls mm-hmm. of water levels. And we take that information and apply our own statistical research to it. We also track and follow the major components that cause water levels to rise and fall. And those are the things that make up the hydrologic cycle: precipitation, runoff, and evaporation. And we try to better understand those things and issue our forecasts based on recent conditions of all three of those hydrologic factors.
Okay, before we start to look at those factors that cause the lake levels to be down low, where are we in terms of historic proportions of where the lakes are right now?
Well, all the lakes are below their long-term average. The lake that seems to get the most attention now is Lakes Michigan and Huron, and the Corps considers them to be one lake because they're joined at the Straits of Mackinac. Mm-hmm. They did set an all-time record low in January of 2013. The water level for any month has never been lower than it was in January. Forecasts done around January and into February showed continued record lows as we moved into the summer, but conditions were such, especially in April with the extreme amounts of rainfall that we saw, that the lakes have come up significantly but still remain well below their long-term average.
So people who live inland may say, okay, so the lake's a little bit lower. What is the impact of that?
Well, the low lake levels impact different groups in different ways. Mm-hmm. Commercial navigation is impacted. They aren't allowed, or they aren't able to load their vessels to full capacity. The recreational boat owner and marina owner might not be able to access their preferred marina. The marina owner might not be able to sell all of his boat slips. And the shoreline property owner is going to see much larger beach, and that may allow certain types of vegetation to emerge that the person who owns that lakefront property might not want to look at. They might want to look at a nice pristine beach, but instead they're now seeing various types of vegetation emerge.
So what can be done to help offset some of these low levels?
Well, the study that we do now is really the most important thing from where I sit with the Corps of Engineers. We need to better understand the components that cause lake levels to fluctuate.
So tell me about those.
Well, the increased rainfall, increased evaporation, the things that we've been seeing trend-wise, we are seeing increased evaporation over the past several decades, matching increasing precipitation too. So it's just a balance. Is there more evaporation occurring that is causing lake levels to decline? Is there more precipitation occurring that causes lake levels to rise? It's really the combination and the battle between those two components that really drive lake level fluctuations.
So bottom line, when we're moving forward and you're starting to give your projections for the next year or so, what can be done to change things? Is there a larger plan that the Army Corps is working on to see how we can offset some of these changes?
Not specifically right now. Again, from where I sit with the Corps, it's more of the natural phenomenon that cause lake levels to rise and fall. And we need to better understand those things to decrease the uncertainty in some of the measurements that we make to better understand what types of atmospheric conditions, what types of hydrologic conditions lead to certain types of water level rise and fall.
All right, so what are people going to see this summer if they are vacationing out on the Great Lakes?
Well, by the time the heart of the summer gets here, June, July, and August, it looks like the lakes will be very similar to where they were a year ago. And that is a direct result of the very wet April we had significant water level mm-hmm. rises, especially on Lakes Michigan, Huron, Lake St. Clair, Lake Erie, and Lake Ontario. The water level rise in April was very much more than it usually goes up. And that will extend, you know, through into summer, and by the time the lakes reach their peak, they'll be very near or maybe even a couple inches above where they were a year ago, but that's still below their long-term average. Our peak water level this summer on Lakes Michigan Huron will still probably be about 20 inches below its long-term average, but mm-hmm. but well above the record lows.
All right, Keith, thanks so much for joining us and explaining a little bit about the work that you do. We appreciate it.
You're very welcome. Thank you.
Okay. Well, our first panel took a look at the intersection of land and water, beaches, shoreline, coastal wetlands, and the importance and difficulty of keeping them clean and safe along the Great Lakes. There are many factors that keep on changing.
Beaches are one of our greatest assets in the Great Lakes. They are a vital part of our tourism industry, offering the quintessential summer getaway for both residents and tourists alike.
So in the summertime in July, I can't think of a better place to be than at one of our Great Lakes beaches. You can just go for a walk and you can see for miles. You know, some of the vantage points in the Great Lakes are you can climb up these sand dunes and see for miles. So it's really exciting to be able to be in those places and smell the fresh air and hear the waves going across the sand and just letting your mind relax.
Making sure our beaches are clean and healthy is becoming a big priority. Extensive monitoring is done to ensure a safe beach experience for the majority of the swimming season.
Beach monitoring is done by the 8 Great Lakes states. US EPA collects every year the results. And over the last 7 years, they've been reporting that 95% of the days where swimming is available, that people can swim.
Typically, when we have beach closures around Michigan and the other Great Lakes states, it's because of bacterial levels, usually E. coli and Enterococci. Bacteria is always in the water. It comes from animal waste, any kind of animals, birds, dogs, humans. And when you have a beach closure, usually it's following a storm event where you may have crossed sewage lines with stormwater drain-off lines that result in extra bacteria in the water bodies in the swimming beaches. But it can come from, even if it's close to marinas, it can come from discharges out of boats, which you're not supposed to do, but people do. It can come from leaky septic systems, agricultural fields. So it can come from a number of sources where you can get waste into the water system.
Monitoring water quality at our beaches is evolving into a more predictive model. This forecasting of water quality conditions will supplement the old persistence model, which takes time to get results and thus make decisions.
We call it the persistence model because we can't get those results back for 18 to 24 hours. And so it's operating the assumption that the water quality from one day is persisting to the next.
And this has been a frustrating situation because they're always getting their data about a day late. You know, the results are coming in a day late. And that's why we're very excited about these new predictive models, because they are helping us take the E. coli results and putting them in context with what's happening at the beach. Did it just rain? What are the waves like? Is the wind direction coming out of the north or the south? A lot of those things we're finding make a difference.
Increasing our monitoring capability is one part of the puzzle. Recent funding is allowing the region to address contamination sources and restore ecosystems that keep our waters clean.
So the beach sanitary surveys have helped us identify sources of contamination, and that's led us to actually remediate and fix about 72 beaches over the past 3 years using the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative funds. So we're very excited that these beaches that have had problems in the past are either being redesigned, the stormwater runoff is being redirected through a coastal wetland or through special chambers, and we're minimizing the impact that stormwater has on our beaches.
You know, we've lost a lot of wetlands around the Great Lakes, and restoring some of those wetlands to be a natural filter for the bacterial and contaminants into our water supply in general is one of the, I think, best ways that you could do this. A lot of forecasters are looking at alternative methods, but the best way is probably really just restoring the natural kidneys of the system, the wetlands.
And we continue here on Great Lakes Now Connect with our second panel. They are tackling water levels and the impact that those changing levels can have. Our moderator is Dr. Patrick Doran, Director of Conservation Programs at the Nature Conservancy.
Thank you, Christy. And thanks to that first panel, I had a great discussion with Katie and the panelists, where they covered quite a variety of issues. But now we're going to focus in a little more specifically on lake levels, the impacts of lake levels across various sectors in the Great Lakes, and perhaps some solutions in how to deal with a great deal of lake level change. But first, I'd like to introduce my panelists. On this side of me, we have John Allen. He works with the state of Michigan, where he's the director of the Office of the Great Lakes. Dr. Drew Gronewald works with NOAA, where he's a hydrologist in the Great Lakes Environmental Research Lab. And over on my far left is Jen Reed. Dr. Jen Reed is a deputy director, University of Michigan Water Center, and executive director of the Great Lakes Observing Center, and Glenn Nekvasil, the vice president of the Lake Carriers Association in Ohio. So thanks for panelists today. I really love that first video when the writer talked about the little slice of the UP, and that we all have that little slice, to me, a little slice of the Great Lakes. So if you want to start, John, what's your little slice of the Great Lakes, but also not just you personally, but in your work, what's that slice of the Great
Lakes? Sure. I was thinking about that question when I saw the video, and in some ways it's like choosing amongst all your children. You love all the little corners of Michigan and the Great Lakes and the U.S. side and the Canadian side to our Canadian friends, but where I go, where my mind goes, actually, whether my body's there or not, where my mind goes, I go to Beaver Island. That's one of the little corners of Michigan and one of the corners of the Great Lakes that I love. I love islands. I'm an island guy, and I think islands sort of encapsulate all the kinds of things we talk about: their community, their home, their family, their working communities. They're also resort communities or summer communities. I think they capture all of those moments for us. As far as the Office of the Great Lakes, where our special corners are, they are all over. I mean, it's really about our relationship to the Great Lakes, our relationship to the shoreline, I think are all really critical for the state and for the region.
Thanks. And Drew, I know you didn't grow up in the Great Lakes region, but where did it start to intersect your life?
Right, that's a good question. So I have a couple of spotty memories here and there from interacting with the Great Lakes, but the one that stands out for this discussion for my work at NOAA right now has to do with sort of taking flights over the Great Lakes. Mm-hmm. And the perspective that gives you on their sheer magnitude. One particular flight is the one from Chicago up to Houghton. And you get to see sort of the whole transect of Lake Michigan. And I remember thinking that on that flight, looking around the plane going, is anybody else blown away by this? And one other part of that is that there are a lot of other water bodies in the country that people notice a lot more readily. For example, Lake Mead or Lake Tahoe or Lake Okeechobee, that are easily identifiable, and one of the things we're trying to work on is to make the Great Lakes a little more recognizable in a national context.
Great. Jen, what do you think? What's one of your first memories?
Wow, that's a really tough question. I do have this awesome memory, though, of, so I grew up in Ontario, northeast of Toronto, away from the Great Lakes, so I didn't have a view of the Great Lakes sort of as a daily experience, but I remember going to Toronto one time and coming down Highway 115, and there's this point where you come around 115 and Lake Ontario opens up in front of you, and I just remember, I mean, too young to understand the concept of sublime, but it was. It was just so large, and it blew me away. And thus, the Great Lakes have sort of drawn me back ever since to study and luckily to work with them. So yeah. Some of the things we do at the Water Center, University of Michigan Water Center, is looking to restoration and helping to think about, you know, are we doing it restoration right, and what kinds of assessment and analysis can we do to improve restoration? And then at the Great Lakes Observing System, making sure we have the data and information we need to really know if we're advancing. What are the baselines that we're measuring against? And then can we see improvements over time?
Yeah, we heard a lot of important stress on availability of data,
right,
to make some really key informed decisions. Mm-hmm. And so, Glenn, you come from the southern side of Lake Erie. What's some of your memories?
Well, it's true that I come from Cleveland, Ohio, but actually in the fall we like to hop in the car and drive up to Barquette, you know, spend the night at the Landmark Inn, and then head over to Duluth, to Fitgers, and maybe run the shore over to Thunder Bay. So we love the Great Lakes, especially in the fall. Professionally, obviously, I wouldn't have an industry if there weren't the Great Lakes. Ships float, and as a matter of fact, that's why they're the greenest form of transportation. There's the least amount of friction as you move a ship through water, so we can move cargo and use less fuel per ton and fewer emissions.
Yeah, as we mentioned earlier, I grew up in a small port town in Conneaut, Ohio, where some of my first memories are going down to the bluffs and watching those ships come in every single day, and always seeing the Bigamon ships, as I called them when I was a little kid. I don't know why I use that word. So our Great Lakes coastal systems, John, tell us some of these. I mean, we heard these favorite places around the Great Lakes, from the north to the south, from the east to the west. We've got quite a resource in our coastal systems here. Tell us just a little bit about the Great Lakes coast. It's more than just the beaches we heard about earlier.
It is. It's really a spectacular suite of resources with different types of ecosystems and different types of human systems as we move from industrial systems to suburban and rural systems on the lakes. We still have some farming that are sort of near the lakes, probably less and less so than we used to in so many ways. Our port communities, our harbor communities, really drive so much of their relationship with the lakes. They are our keyholes out onto the Great Lakes, whether you have a large boat, a small boat, a canoe, a kayak. These are ways that we get on. Beaches, obviously, are really critical and important points of entry as we relate and interrelate. There's something about life at the edge, right? There's something about the sound of water. There's something about being able to look out and see that expanse of the world that is infinite. We've had some friends come and visit us, you know, and from the east and the west coast, and they look out and say, you can't see the other side. No, you can't. These are vast, defining resources for us. But how we live our life at our coastal, at the coastal zone, is so critical. How we live our life and how nature exists within the fluctuations that are provided. And we're going to talk a lot about water levels over the next hour, but water levels come and go. They come up, they go down. Those are also part and parcel to healthy systems, and how humans interact at those margins also help define the health of our system. So we have beautiful diversity, but we also have beautiful human diversity at the water's edge too.
So Drew, in your work with NOAA, where you're a scientist, and I know that you're getting out a lot, talking to a lot of user groups, and John says the we. Who are the people that are coming to you? Because there's a lot of different sectors that are looking for that data, for that information, for those predictions. What are those sectors that are coming to you and your group for that type of information?
Yeah, right. The user group covers the whole gamut. A few highlights include the hydropower industry. They want to understand the water level dynamics and how they can make better projections of power. The shipping industry, as we'll find out more about later.
but even individual homeowners. We get phone calls from individuals, many of whom, own cottages or shoreline property. A good example are the homeowners in Georgian Bay who call and have questions about long-term water level changes and short-term water level changes. And we take a lot of pride in being able to answer some of those questions. And fortunately, we have a lot of very good data that we can use to help answer those questions.
So, Jen, he mentioned some homeowners in different places around the Great Lakes, from Georgian Bay, where we have a very rocky coast, to some of our more highly erodible coasts, some of our beach. What are some of the various lake level issues in those communities?
Great question, Patrick. You know, and I think it depends whether the water is going up or coming down and nodding at the long-term average as it on its way by. But, as you know, you mentioned some highly erodible areas, obviously under systems or situations where we have higher water levels, we run into problems of erosion. We've seen in the late 1980s, when the water levels were very high, that we had homes falling into Lake Michigan and other areas where there's those kinds of dangers. What we're just experiencing now for the last maybe 10 years or so would be long-term lows. And in situations like Georgian Bay, where it's more rocky and it's harder to dredge or otherwise improve your access to your cottage or your home, you have problems of access to the waterfront. And so those are the kinds of situations people run into.
So in preparation for this discussion today, I always do this before I talk. I go to Google and I go to Google News and I type in Great Lakes water levels, and I got 6,000 different news stories. I mean, it's really 6,000 different news stories in the recent past year or two, which amazes me. And I read from all different perspectives. And I know I'm reading it, and I know there's some myths. I know a lot of things get some news that might not really be the big issue. So I want to kind of hit first, kind of let's just try to dispel some of these myths. And these are really the questions I also get, the very first questions you get from somebody. You know, tell me about all the water that's leaving through the Chicago area waterway. So is that a drop in the bucket, Drew, or is that something we really should be paying attention to?
Yeah, it really is. The major drivers of the water level change in the Great Lakes system are the interplay between precipitation over this massive area and evaporation off the lake surfaces themselves.
So when somebody says, oh, the St. Clair River is the reason why lake levels are low.
Right. The main drivers of the water levels are the precipitation and evaporation over the long term. Other factors such as the flow between the lakes certainly have a factor, certainly have an impact. The Chicago diversion is really a very small amount of water relative to these other factors, as are some of the other diversions of water that come into and out of the Great Lakes Basin.
Right. And so, John, I know you deal a lot with water withdrawals and with the state and your past work with the Great Lakes Compact and water withdrawal tools. Some people are also worried about, you know, all the various withdrawals for all different purposes and leaving the basin or coming to the basin. Again, is that something that is really the main things we should pay attention to, or are those kind of peripheral things?
Well, I think how we withdraw water and how we use water and how we put water back does matter. I think in the great hydrologic cycle of the Great Lakes, as Drew mentioned, the diversions that we've seen, the diversions in, whether it's in Superior, the diversions out, are still small parts of an overall hydrologic cycle, and those are still fairly large numbers. How we use water within the system matters. It matters a lot. How we withdraw water from small systems, you know, small tributaries, matters a lot at that scale. But in terms of the overall scale of the Great Lakes, we're talking about fairly small amounts of water. Remember that the same amount of water is on the earth as there's always been. We haven't made more or lost more water, so it's really about where it is at any one period of time. So as we talk about storms coming in and going out, it's really driven by storm systems, snow systems, evaporation systems, ice cover, these large controlling factors. But I don't want to underplay how we use water within the system matters.
Great. So what we can do now is we're going to cut away to a video that's going to kind of talk about lake levels, and then we're going to dive back into some of these mechanisms and why, how they really drive and impact the various sectors that we represent. So, Christy, to the video.
The Great Lakes are a dynamic and powerful freshwater system. Coastal communities and ecosystems are always adapting the ever-changing conditions on our coasts This January, Lakes Michigan and Huron saw their lowest water levels ever recorded, the impacts of which are seen not only at our beaches, but throughout nearly every sector of our economy.
Low lake levels are presenting incredible challenges for lots of different user groups. When you look at navigation, the big ships that carry commodities through the Great Lakes, whether it's iron ore or grain, they have to light load, and that costs them money and that costs jobs.
For every inch of water depth that we lose, one of our 1,000-foot ships gives up 270 tons of cargo for each inch each trip. It's a tremendous inefficiency that's built into our system. It trickles throughout the supply chain, and at the end of the day will result in more expensive steel, more expensive power, more expensive roads, and more expensive homes.
Recreational boating is another industry feeling the effects of low water levels. With federal dredging dollars stretched thin, some Great Lakes harbors are left to fend for themselves. The Detroit Yacht Club is one group that is funding their own dredging project so their members can safely navigate the harbor this boating season.
We've been here on the banks of the Detroit River for 145 years. And for us, the water is our way of life. And without that, we're sunk. So we know that we got to make the investment and literally dig ourselves out of this one. We've got only a couple feet of water here right now, and we're hoping to get down to about 6 feet of water. And without that, boats are hitting the bottom, propellers are hitting the bottom, churning up mud with every excursion leaving the dock. And if we let it go too much longer, if we don't get some water back, we wouldn't be able to float them at all.
The low water levels we're seeing now are just part of a bigger picture in the basin. We need to understand how to deal with the range of conditions we'll see in the long term.
The challenge today, in 2013, is low levels. We've had, a record low in January that was the lowest that we've ever recorded on Lake Michigan and Lake Huron. But in 1986, we had the highest level ever recorded. So these, the challenges, they come and they go. And what we need to do, though, is to do the kind of monitoring and modeling on a regular basis to kind of get a better understanding of why the lakes go up and down the way they do, and then to help planners and managers to do a better job of adapting to the lakes than they do now.
One of the clear needs within the Great Lakes community that we've sensed is a need to be able to view and understand this data, the water level data, and the drivers behind water levels over these various timescales. NOAA and other organizations are continuously doing research on how to better understand what's happening with regard to the water budget and water levels, and how we can use that understanding to improve our projections.
Changing lake levels can cause headaches for humans living near the coast, but from a biological standpoint, fluctuating lake levels are integral to coastal ecosystem health.
That up and down, that natural up and down, is what is good for the environment. In the past, by regulating water levels, say on Lake Ontario, regulation has destroyed wetlands. Many of the wetlands on Lake Ontario are gone. And so our commission is working on trying to restore a more natural up and down of the system in Lake Ontario so we can restore those wetlands. The lakes are very dynamic, and we need to learn to live with what Mother Nature gives us rather than trying to change it.
The more lake level related challenges our infrastructure, ecosystems, and economy faces, the more complex the issue becomes. The best asset we have in dealing with water levels is increasing knowledge and foresight and helping the basin's decision makers adapt to our best understanding.
The changes that we are seeing right now are real and present. It's the how can we help folks access new information so that they can adapt to the changes that aren't currently being realized, but that may be exacerbated down the road.
Thank you. That's a great video. And it talked a lot about both behavior of people, our infrastructure, our predictability, and the impacts of Great Lakes levels. But I think before we can begin to talk about some solutions and impacts to our particular sector of society, we have to understand lake levels and why lake levels change and how they have changed over the long term and how they're predicted to change into the future. So, Drew, can you kind of first just characterize the past for us? I know you are the master of data, and I've seen your computer models and your Great Lakes dashboard. So tell us a little bit about what does the past look like in terms of lake levels throughout the Great Lakes?
Sure.
Well, part of the answer to that question starts off with the fact that we're very fortunate to have a long period of record, a long data set, where we have water level measurements that go back into the mid-1800s. So that forms the basis for our understanding of this long-term trends. And what we've seen over time are, as we've indicated before, periods of highs and periods of low water levels. Most notably, in the mid-1960s, around 1964, was the last period of lows and on most of the systems, followed by a period of highs in the mid-1980s. And we find that these water levels relate very closely with major changes in precipitation patterns over the basin.
Okay, so this gets at some of the mechanisms that really drive. So what are some of those important variables or factors and mechanisms that cause these changes in water levels?
Sure. So the big three that we tend to talk about are precipitation over the lake, over the lakes themselves, keeping in mind that these lakes are huge. About a third of the entire basin area is surface water. And there's no other system like that on the planet in terms of fresh water where there's that much water area. So over lake evaporation, over lake precipitation, and then finally the third is runoff. Those three together, we call them collectively the net basin supply of water. And that volume of water that comes in really dictates the rate at which water levels rise and the rate at which they fall, along with other factors such as how much water is flowing in from an upstream lake and how much water flows to a downstream lake. Those things together in concert dictate the water levels.
And so, but we also see some long-term variability, and we see some seasonal or short-term variability as well, correct?
Absolutely, yep. So within the course of an individual year, typically a cycle will start off where we'll have snow melt and precipitation in the early spring. Water levels typically rise during that time of year. Water levels typically will peak during the summertime. And then throughout the fall, when we see a lot of the evaporation, the combination of cool air coming in over the lakes coupled with warm water is really what drives evaporation. And then water levels will drop typically into the wintertime and then repeat that cycle. That's sort of the typical cycle, right? And those are the drivers of that cycle.
And so we've seen a lot of rains this spring, and I've seen some data show that Lake Michigan went up, John, a few inches on Lake Michigan,
substantially more than that, yeah.
So is that a normal type of spring event, or is that something just different about this particular spring?
Well, keep in mind that normal is an average over a long period of time. So any one year may not be normal. In fact, there may not be a lot of normals. Normal is an average. What we experience is what reality is, not necessarily what an average is. So last year we saw a early, warm, dry spring, and lake levels came up maybe 4 inches. I think I've seen the data. This year, if you remember, we've had a cooler, wetter spring with a substantial amount of water coming into the system. And the lake levels have risen as quickly as I can remember on the graphs. I'm not sure if it's historically quickly, but it sure feels like it. I'm sure if you've been in communities with flooding, you probably felt that water levels came up quite quickly. So I'd say over last year and this year, it was probably on average, but we didn't experience average. We experienced a warm, dry year, and we experienced a cool, wet year. But that is really what we have to learn to live with within the Great Lakes. That is what nature provides us as variability.
So Glenn, in the shipping or navigation industry, how do they pay attention to lake levels? What do you look for? What are the data, or where do you plug into monitoring lake levels?
Well, we get our water level information from the Corps and from NOAA, and it's critically important for our industry. Depending on the size of your ship, you carry anywhere from 50 to 270 tons of cargo for each inch that you're submerged in the water. So the problem is here now with these low water levels, we're losing in some instances 2.5 feet of draft. So that means ships that used to come down to St. Clair with 70,000 tons of coal for the power plant, they're now coming in with about 60,000 tons. And that's the same thing for the ships that are taking iron ore to the steel mills in Detroit, the ships that are loading limestone in Rogers City, calcite, Cedarville, they're leaving cargo behind because of these lower water levels.
And so can the industry be adaptable when they see a short level change like the springtime? I mean, are you paying attention week to week or month to month?
You pay attention to water. You pay attention to almost on an hourly basis. I mean, obviously the last thing you want to have happen is have your boat hit bottom. Right. So water levels are critically important to us.
So Chen, can you comment on the value? It seems like data like we're collecting with NOAA or with the Army Corps are incredibly valuable in some of the observing systems. So how much value do we place in those types of data? Do people see it? Do they not see it? Do they understand how valuable they are? Do they not?
That's a great question. I think, unfortunately, in general, people don't recognize the value of the data. I think the end users certainly do, and the ones who rely on it to make critical decisions really understand how valuable it is to have the systems out there to collect the data, to integrate the data, and report the data. The challenge is translating that for the rest of us who are paying taxes to support these systems to understand then why it's important to maintain these systems over time. Right. Not just in times of low water to make sure ships aren't hitting bottom, but just to have a long-term average or long-term understanding. These long-term data sets are key for planning, for projecting what might happen in the future. For all the important decisions we'll be making.
So let's talk a little bit about the future. I know in the past panel, Katie mentioned climate change and some of the trends we've seen in precipitation, one of the major inputs, as well as some of the future projections of those. And I know you were part of the International Joint Commission, where together we served on an adaptive management team, which took into account climate change impacts on lake level. So can you tell me just a little bit about some of the potential, some of the future for lake level changes?
Well, I think that's the real takeaway I brought from it was there's still a lot of uncertainty about what that future looks like. Are levels going to be down consistently over the time? Are they going to be up? And I think we've seen multiple scenarios where they're up and down. And I think the takeaway then in thinking about living along the shore and living with the lakes, as the point was made in the last video segment, is to adapt to the potential of levels going up and coming down. Mm-hmm. Understanding where you are in a certain location, if you're vulnerable to highs or lows, and planning for those highs and lows, and making sure that your community, your business, your even your property, that you've done everything you can to adapt to those potentials.
So John, I know you're a big fan of thinking about risk and scenarios and future. So how do you think about risk? How do you think about that and the decisions that you either advise in your position or decisions that a homeowner makes?
I think it plays out in decisions that both individuals make, and I think it plays out in the way decisions that communities make and companies make. So if a company is designing a water intake structure, they have to think about that water intake structure relative to a range of water levels, then looking at the map and saying, here's a mean water level, let's always assume that it's going to be at that mean water level. So that matters in how you ultimately look at things like infrastructure or dock walls or even docks that can be raised and lowered, as opposed to a dock that's now fixed and in 10 years water levels are higher or lower and we're looking at that dock saying, gee, I wish I'd built a different dock. But we can engineer systems at the water's edge to understand that those waters come and go, understanding what bulkheads look like and what water pressure on bulkheads look like with that water coming and going matters. When you build a wall and you have water against it, that water pushes against that wall. When water drops, that wall tends to want to fall in because there's no more water pressure on that. Understanding the nature of dynamics and hydrologics on infrastructure matters. So all those things are individual decisions we can make, whether it's at the business level, the community level, planning playgrounds and beaches, or at the homeowner level in terms of what does my relationship to that lake look like. So those are all important things that we can decide on as individuals.
So let's take one quick step back here and think about those various sectors of society that we talked about. And what are the impacts of lake level changes, or the impacts of high levels or low levels, or variability, or sustained high levels or sustained low levels? And I'm going to quiz you around to hit on a few of them. So Jen, what about kind of the recreational or tourism industry? Again, it's one thing where I have seen lots of newspaper articles talking about low level impacts on recreation, tourism, marinas.
Absolutely. Anybody who's tried to drop a boat in the last couple years knows that many of our boat launches are high and dry, whether those are state launches or at private marinas or in municipal marinas. And so that's been an impact for sure. But those same boat launches, when water is high, are equally unusable because those are fixed infrastructure and they can't really adapt to levels going up and down. So we've seen, communities, several communities around the state where their access to the big lake as it is much more shallow than usual, so they can't get the big ships in. They can't get by big, not necessarily big commercial vessels, but fixed keel sailboats or the larger, you know, 40-foot recreational vessels. That has a huge economic impact on those communities that rely on that traffic to come into their communities, spend the money, buy the gas. It's kind of like the beach closing story. If you can't get those people in to recreate in your community to go fishing and all the things that they would normally want to do with their vessels, they're not spending their money there. They're going to the next community where they can.
So, Glenn, you talked about some of the impacts of low levels and having to lighten the load a little bit. What about when we have sustained high levels? Do you see some kind of impacts to access and impacts as well?
Yeah, actually, high water levels are not quite the boon you would think they are to ship operators. First of all, you can reach a point where your ship is going to be too high in the water and can't get under the loading rig. And then also, too, when water is very high in the connecting channels, you have to slow down so that you're not creating wake. But the current situation that we're in, where we have the low water levels, is having a tremendous impact. As I said, we're losing 10,000 tons of cargo. That has obviously an impact on the ship operator, but remember, it takes 1.5 tons of iron ore to make a ton of steel. It takes 85,000 tons of aggregate to build a road, a mile of highway. So the fact that we can't deliver as much cargo as we should is having impacts throughout the whole economy. And we have here on the lakes basically a fixed navigation season. Right. We have 10 months to deliver our customers' annual needs. And you can't make the ships go any faster. They're already running at their maximum speed. It's not like you can take your car and, okay, we're going to go 70 miles an hour for a while. You can't do that with a ship. So we have 10 months to get our job done. That's why we have to get this dredging backlog cleared up. We've got 18 million cubic yards of sediment clogging our harbors, and that's got to be resolved.
So John, tell us a little bit about ecology and the ecosystems and the natural systems. How do they respond to or perhaps need lake level changes and fluctuations?
Well, Drew mentioned humans have been monitoring the Great Lakes. Probably some of the oldest monitored freshwater systems in the world. I'm guessing that's pretty close. So clearly that variability has been with us a long time, and it's mattered. But we've also seen that, we know that variability was even greater earlier, over many, 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 many centuries. So the lakes have adapted, water at the margin has adapted to be a healthy system in a fluctuating system. Wetlands come and go as water levels rise and lower. So it relies on sort of those natural processes at the water's edge. As water ebbs out, right, as it leaves our system, as it falls into these lower periods, we see a lot of emergence of aquatic vegetation, for instance. And as water levels come back, those become nursery grounds for fisheries. So that's a part of a healthy dynamic. We also recognize that as that vegetation grows, now with invasive species, now with Phragmites, that starts to cause problems for other individuals as those dominate the shoreline in these cases. But the variability of the lakes in and of themselves is a part of the healthy function. Mm. Now, variability within a certain band, is it going to stay low? Is it going to stay lower than average? Is that trend a long-term trend that we need to attend to with things like climate change and these other sort of climatological factors? That starts to make us look at the system a little bit differently.
Sure.
But these are healthy functioning systems at the margin's edge with water variability.
So Drew, you did talk a little bit about the hydropower industry and imagine municipal water users too. Where do they run into trouble both at the highs and the lows of lake levels?
That's a good question. I would say that when water levels are not, well, one of the factors is that when we cannot predict what's going to happen. And when I say we, there's a strong partnership in the Great Lakes region that puts together forecasts of water levels and flows. It's a very big challenge for the hydropower industry if they can't predict the amount of flow mm-hmm. coming through and plan accordingly for the distribution of power. That's one of the biggest challenges that they would face.
Right. All right, so we've talked about some of these impacts to various parts of the Great Lakes and the Great Lakes industry and our Great Lakes way of life. Let's spend this last 10 minutes or so on solutions. What are we going to do? What can we do, both infrastructure, our management decisions, and I imagine we'll probably get to a little bit of behavioral shifts and behavioral decisions. So what about near term? Glenn, you mentioned an immediate need for dredging. So can you characterize where and what and who and how?
Well, dredging is needed throughout the entire Great Lakes system. As I said, we have 18 million cubic yards. Right now, what is usually setting the draft, though, is a stretch of the St. Mary's River that is right below the Sioux Locks. And the thing that's so irritating to industry, we have in this country what's called a Harbor Maintenance Trust Fund, and it is funded by a tax that is assessed on cargo. This is a national tax. It takes in about $1.6 billion a year, but the government only spends about $800 million. They're using the rest of it to what we call paper balance the budget. They're trying to mask the size of the federal deficit. So this fund has a surplus of $7 billion. It's going to grow to $9 billion. And meanwhile, we, as I said, we're losing 10,000 tons of cargo. The Port of St. Joe is closed. Holland, Michigan has been closed a couple times. We lost the coal trade to Dunkirk, New York, because we can't get ships in that harbor. So we have legislation right now that would require the government to spend what the Harbor Maintenance Trust Fund brings in each year. And that would, in a relatively short period of time, get the Great Lakes and actually the whole nation's waterway systems dredged to project dimensions again.
So how many harbors are we talking about around the Great Lakes?
Yeah, on the U.S. side of the lakes, we have 60 harbors that are federally maintained and then some others that are privately maintained.
So that funding goes to the federally maintained?
Federally maintained, yes.
So, Jen, what about the dredging issue for the other side, or John even, what about the dredging issue for the marina, the kind of the public access?
The public access. Well, there's a whole other part of this system that we're referring to, which is sort of the small harbors, the shallow harbors. Many of those are also federally authorized, but also some state authorized and locally maintained harbors as well. And those have an even larger, I would say, dredging backlog and a pretty important need there too. Now, I know the state has just announced, in Michigan at least, some emergency dredging dredging for those particular harbors. I think John would be well-placed to speak to that because it's a very important step.
Yeah, so John, can you just tell us a little of the mechanisms? Are there sticking points in this funding? Is there a backlog? Is there some need?
Well, there was great backlog, and as water levels hit their historic lows, that highlighted the need for dredging our recreational communities, our recreational harbors, our ports. And I think the governor, his staff, and the legislature recognized early on, as we started to get into this cycle, that dredging was going to become an important part to make sure Michigan was open for business. So the legislature and the governor's office, working all together, were able to come up with about $21 million in Michigan to put on the table to make sure our communities were able to contract for the kinds of dredging they needed, so we do have that recreational season.
Now, are those dollars similar to the federal dollars?
These were state dollars, so general fund dollars were allocated by the legislature, and then the Waterways Commission, I think they did a beautiful job working the Waterways Commission in reallocating some dollars that they had available to them that had initially been going to some infrastructure projects. They said, yes, we need infrastructure, but what we really need is to make sure that we have a boating season in Michigan and that people can get on the water. So they were able to redirect those, and they came up with a package of about $21 million to be able to see the kinds of activity that we needed to make sure that we have that recreation season. I say that we don't want to get ourselves in that position every year, so right. What we really want to do is start to look long-term at what sediment management systems need to look like. So it's not just always digging our way out. Yes, we were at that point, low water level, sediment, lack of federal funding in this case, certainly on the commercial side, but we want to make sure that we understand where the sediment's coming from, how it's getting there, keeping it out of the system before it gets in is a lot better than trying to dig it out at the end of the system.
So we'll get into some of those long-term. But are there any other short-term solutions that people are dealing with or proposing right now, kind of immediate impacts, anything the landowner or homeowner can do immediately, or any actions you see out there that might even be maladaptive a couple years down the road? I mean, the dredging issue is the one that's on the top of everybody's
mind. That's the one that's really been driving the system in terms of getting boats on the water. Right. I think ultimately as we look at behavior, we can talk about that in a little bit. Sure. These are a little longer term strategies for making sure that we understand that. I mean, part of it is making sure that people do know that we're open for business, that there are places. I mean, obviously, call ahead.
Yeah.
You know, there may be a community or two that has shallower water than before. So part of it's we talked about with beaches. Call ahead, make sure you understand your water system, where you're going to go, make sure your marina's open. Mm-hmm. If you're boating to another state, understand that.
Right.
And so I think there's some short-term that people can do just in terms of the way they think about their vacation season or planning ahead.
So let's think about longer term, and you mentioned some interesting things with the intersection, not just of lake level change, but also of perhaps some contaminants in those sediments we have to think about, or the sources of those sediments where we can't just be working on the Band-Aid solution down here. We have to get to the source of the problem. Does the industry think about the sediment, the input as well? And
as a matter of fact, that's something that came up at a conference that we were at last week. I'm told at least that most of what's dredged out of the Maumee River in Toledo, Ohio, is Indiana farmland. The problem is the Corps of Engineers said their authority stops at the waterline. So I don't know how we're going to get the people in Indiana, and I'm not picking on Indiana here, folks, but I don't know. We it is certainly something we need to do, because you're absolutely right. Why should we keep dredging the Maumee River and the Cuyahoga River every year if we could just stop this influx? There was a study in Ohio, I think 54% of what we dredge out of the Cuyahoga River is farmland that has washed down from above.
And we mentioned the first panel, they don't want to be losing that farmland. No, they want to keep that to farm. Because
I wish Indiana would stay in Indiana. Yes. I mean, believe me.
So what do you see, Jen, in terms of some of these? Another big thing is the infrastructure that we have. And I'm always fascinated. We can go to our salty coasts, and people are used to daily changes in lake levels. And they have as many marinas, and they have as many boats, and they have as many ports. But it seems to me that we often start to get a little surprised when lake levels change. So what can we do long-term about some of our infrastructure from, well, we'll talk to Glenn here about some of the major infrastructure, right, but also some of the marinas, some of the boat accesses. How do we begin to rethink our design and our development of the infrastructure?
Well, that's definitely something we thought about as part of the Upper Great Lakes study, and really thinking about in the adaptive management regime, sort of how do you plan so that you can handle high water levels and low water levels. And I think we've mentioned a few of them here already, but you know, putting an infrastructure that docks, for example, that can float so that you don't have to worry that you're all of a sudden you've got 4 feet between you and the boat you're trying to get onto. Similarly, you know, making sure that your water intake is far enough out into the lake or the river, wherever you're getting your water from, that it's not going to be affected. It's below a certain level that it needs to be to get good, clean water. It's not going to get affected by, if you're in Lake Erie, for example, water that doesn't have oxygen in it. And, you know, there are a number of ways to think about it. But that takes understanding sort of what does the system look like, and understanding a longer-term data set. And then also understanding what are the warnings looking ahead. So what are those performance indicators for whatever your adaptive strategy is, making sure that your strategy is working. And so monitoring the data to understand and changing your adaptations, tweaking them a little bit as you move along. That's the sort of management side of adaptive management.
Glenn, do you see the shipping industry looking 15, 20, 50, 100 years out in the future and thinking about their infrastructure decisions or their ship design or anything else?
Well, you know, the physics of shipping haven't changed much.
No.
A ship floats because it displaces more water than it weighs. So we don't have any innovative right, designs out there that can increase our carrying capacity. But I guess at the risk of sounding like a broken record, the answer for us is dredging. Because, for example, if you go out and order a new boat today, okay, a 1,000-foot-long ship probably going to be $150 million, and it'll take 2 years to get here. And frankly, I don't know how you're going to get a bank to finance it when you're going to tell the bank, I'm only can use 80% of the ship's capacity right now. So, again, for us, the issue is we've got to get the system restored to project dimensions.
So, John, let's hit on behavior a little bit and expectations, because I think a lot of it gets to be our own personal behavior. Sometimes we go up north and are just uncomfortable looking at a lot of bottomland that's now exposed. We got to get over that, don't we?
Well, I don't know if getting over it's the right word, but I think understanding in shallow systems, for instance, if you live in a shallow embayment, water levels just don't rise and lower. It looks, I mean, they do go up, but the way you experience that is with more and less beach. Mm-hmm. So you look out there and you see this great expanse of beach, and it is alarming. We understand that people see parts of the bottomlands of our Great Lakes that have been exposed in their lifetime. But we also have to understand, if you look over the 100, 150 years of records that Drew's talked about, that NOAA's done some beautiful work in putting those on the web. People can see that. We're still really within the bandwidth that we've been in for about 100 years. We've been low. We've been lower than average for this period of time. It has great effect on both our harbors and our shipping industry, and we have to make sure that we're accommodating and understanding that. Right. But as we look at that water, we're also really looking at natural systems and the way that they fluctuate. What we're trying to do is understand how humans interact with that. And that does start to take a little bit of a mindset. Mm-hmm. Do I bring the lake levels, you know, to some fixed point forever and say this is average and thus they have to always be this way? Or do I say we'd have to understand what this long-term trajectory looks like and how do we design into that?
Well, that kind of hits on all the things from infrastructure to behavior. But let's go and grab some questions from the video. First, we'll go to a video question that we have.
My name's Ray Edwards. I do have a question about the Great Lakes with these water levels so low. When do the biologists think this water level is going to come up? Because it's probably down 2 feet and it's been like that for 2 years.
All right, so Drew, this is going to be one for you as the hydrologist on the panel. So when do we expect to see responses? And to me, I think there's kind of both a short-term response and, you know, within a season response versus a yearly type response.
Right, so the video question in terms of when will water levels come back up, there's a little bit of context there. As we talked about earlier, there's a seasonal cycle within the year that the Great Lakes follow, and Great Lakes are rising, the water levels are rising right now, particularly on Michigan and Huron. From a longer-term perspective, it's important to recognize that, as John just noted, that the water levels, particularly on Michigan and Huron, have in fact been relatively stable for about the past 13 years or so. They dropped dramatically in the late 1990s, and by dramatically I mean about 3 feet over the course of a few years. And since then have been relatively stable. In terms of when will water levels come up another 2 feet or go back down another 2 feet, we really don't know. It depends a lot on being able to first be able to project precipitation and evaporation rates into the future. And right now, that's something that's very hard to do anywhere on the planet.
All right, we have one question from the audience here.
Hi, Jim Newman from the Detroit Yacht Club. I know there's a lot of talk about contingency plans for continued long-term low water levels. Are there any in place if they dropped even further than they're at right now? Is there any plan currently in place for federal assistance or state assistance?
Chen, do you want to talk a little bit about kind of contingency plans or adaptive management that can impact lake levels into the future?
Well, yeah, so adaptive management
is... You have like 30 seconds or a minute to cover it all,
okay.
Jen. Sorry.
The short version is, adaptive management is sort of a longer-term strategy. So if lake levels were to drop dramatically next year, and we wouldn't necessarily have anything in place to address that. It would require more emergency measures like we've seen this summer with dredging from the state. But over the longer term, there's a number of things we can think about, and we should be thinking about those. New infrastructure... that's adaptive, just addressing I think really it's an infrastructure question and making sure that your infrastructure goes up and down with lake levels.
Well, we can also then talk about regulating flows in and out of the Lake Superior and in Ontario as well a little bit.
Well, I mean, Lake Superior regulation is great for Lake Superior, but what we found under the study and what we've known for years, it has very little impact on Michigan Huron. Lake Ontario, they do a great job there for Lake Ontario, but again, that leaves Michigan Huron and Erie really natural, and learning to live with that is going to be key to the future.
All right, so we have about a minute left for kind of closing comments on lake levels and your thoughts and anything else we should know. John?
I'll just say... The Great Lakes are beautiful, complex, important systems. They sort of define a region. They're one of the greatest natural systems that are governed by 8 states and 2 provinces and 2 countries, and we do it collectively and collaboratively. Lake levels are a piece of that governance mechanism. And I think how we're best when we do this together. We're best when we come together and look at these systems as a system and that we plan accordingly. Mm-hmm. When we look at transportation as a system, when we look at the ecological health of the system as a system, we're best when we work together.
Well, great, John, and thanks to everybody on the panel. It was very enlightening, and it seems, again, that we need to be thinking not only short-term, but very long-term. We need to think about not just lake levels, but all the threats and all the impacts of the system, because they all tend to intersect and combine and operate together. But thank you very much, and we're going to head back to Christy in the booth.
Thank you.
All right, thanks so much, Patrick. You're right, lake levels impacting so many people, and also talking about the cleanliness of our beaches here today on Great Lakes Now Connect. And joining me is Shannon Briggs. She's a toxicologist with the DEQ and in charge of coordinating beach monitoring in Michigan, which has got to be a huge job, Shannon. Thanks so much for joining me.
Thank you.
So go ahead and tell us what that all entails when you have to keep track of every beach in the state of Michigan.
Well, the DEQ is partnering with all of our local health departments. The local health officer has the authority to make these decisions, because we're talking about a decision that affects public health. So this is a really interesting piece of data. Their water quality data, the bacteria levels, are impacting our public health decisions. So we like to partner with all of our local health departments to help them get the best tools, these forecast systems and the water quality, the rapid testing, and help them monitor their beaches with the best information so they can make these decisions that impact our communities. But also we want to help them find the sources of these contaminants. That's really key. A lot of the new rapid methods can help us find these sources along with the forecast systems. Because in order to understand how the water is impacted, once we find all of the things that impact the water, then we can start pointing to some of the sources so we understand the relationship. And then that helps us identify, confirm those sources, and then mitigate them, eliminate them, or remodify or redesign a beach. And we're doing that with several beaches right now in Michigan, actually redesigning the beach and the way stormwater will flow to the water, or to the beach water, so we can mitigate these problems. Because we want to have all of our beaches open all of the time.
So obviously technology and the advance of science and this monitoring has really helped over the last number of years here in Michigan. So what beaches have you started to target to try to change the system so we're not having those continual closures?
Right. In Michigan, we're able to monitor about 400 beaches, about 200 on the Great Lakes and 200 on inland lakes. And again, this is in cooperation with all the local health departments. So our local communities are really taking the lead on all of this, on this work. And after a few years, we've been able to kind of see patterns. And a rain event, a significant rain event, will cause beach closures across the state. And that makes sense. As the water comes on the land, it'll wash off into the streams, the creeks, and eventually out to the beach water. So that's kind of like a spike. We'll see that. That's a precipitation-driven beach closure. Mm-hmm. But then we have some other beaches that are kind of vulnerable to some of the impacts of contamination. And so we're working with communities to identify those sources of contamination and eliminate them, or in some ways mitigate them so that they're not causing these problems. So we're tracking probably 100 beaches that have some issues at times, and we're going to be working on them. Already we've addressed, in some way, the local communities are working with about 25 of those beaches to fix them so that they are no longer vulnerable to the impacts of contamination.
And they're ready for people to come out and enjoy this summer. Thanks so much, Shannon, for joining me. I appreciate it. And thanks so much for joining us today. We'd like to thank Patrick Doran and Catherine Call, our moderators today on Great Lakes Now Connect. It has been a great conversation about beaches, shorelines. Even if you don't live along the water or have a business that directly ties to the Great Lakes, this does economically impact all of us. To learn more about Great Lakes issues and solutions, what is happening in your area, just go to greatlakesnow.org for more information and to learn more about the Nature Conservancy as well. You can also find parts of this program you might have missed and share it with your friends. Find us on Twitter and Facebook at Great Lakes Now. And for all of us at Detroit Public TV and the Nature Conservancy, we hope you've enjoyed Great Lakes Now Connect. I'm Christy McDonald. Take care.